Last time we went over Kirchhoff's current and voltage laws. Now we're going to see how those laws can be used in conjunction with Ohm's law to solve a circuit. Kirchhoff's current law, or Kcl, defines a relationship between all the currents in a circuit. Kirchhoff's voltage law, or KVL, defines a relationship between all the voltages. Ohm's law defines a relationship between voltage and current. So using these three together allows us to determine all the voltages and currents in a resistive circuit. Let's start with the following circuit. For purposes of this problem, I'm going to define solving the circuit as determining all the voltages and currents in the circuit. That being the case, we'll have to begin by defining all the voltages and currents that are not known. Let's start with the 11 ohm resistor. If we define the voltage across the 11 ohm resistor as V1, then following the passive sign convention, the current would have to go in a direction so that it enters the positive terminal of the defined voltage. If we define the voltage across the 5 ohm resistor as V2, then again, the current must enter the positive terminal of that voltage. The same is true for the voltage across the 12 ohm resistor and the current through it, and the voltage across the 8 ohm resistor and the current through it. Since the current from the source is also unknown, I can assign a variable to it also. In this case, because it is a source, the current will leave the positive terminal of the voltage source. At this point, we have three laws that apply to circuits: Ohm's law, Kirchhoff's current law, and Kirchhoff's voltage law. We'll begin by writing the Ohm's law relationships for the resistors. So we write V1 equals 11 ohms times I1, V2 equals 5 ohms times I2, V3 equals 12 ohms times I3, and V4 equals 8 ohms times I4. Now let's turn to Kirchhoff's current law. To apply Kirchhoff's current law, we will first need to identify the nodes at which we're going to write Kcl equations. The circuit has four nodes. We can write the equations for all the unknown currents if we write equations for the top three nodes. Since all of the unknown currents are already included in the equations we'll write for these three nodes, writing an equation for the bottom node would provide no new information and would not help us solve the problem. Once the nodes are identified, it is helpful to label them for purposes of reference. I'll call the left-hand node node A, the center node B, and the right-hand node C. We can then write our KCL equations for each node. I'll write them in the form that the currents entering must equal the currents leaving. So at node A, IS enters and I1 leaves. At node B, I1 enters and I2 and I3 leave. At node C, I3 enters and I4 leaves. We can then move on to write the KVL equations for the unknown voltages. To apply KVL, we'll first need to identify loops that cover all the unknown voltages. Let's identify the left-hand loop as L1 and the right-hand loop as L2. As I mentioned in the previous video, if when I go around in the direction of the arrow, I go from a negative to a positive, I will call that a voltage increase and write it as a positive voltage in the equation. If I go from a positive to a negative, I will call that a voltage decrease and write it as a negative voltage in the equation. So for L1, we go up by 15 volts, down by V1, and down by V2. So the equation we get is 15 volts minus V1 minus V2 equals 0, since all the voltages around any closed loop must equal 0. Going around L2, we go up by V2, down by V3, and down by V4. We end up with V2 minus V3 minus V4 equals 0. Now we have all the equations that describe the currents and voltage relationships for our circuit. We have four equations from Ohm's law, three equations from KCL, and two equations from KVL. That gives us nine equations with nine unknowns. The rest is algebra. Let's begin by combining the Ohm's law equations with the KVL equations. We can do this simply substituting in the Ohm's law relationships into the KVL equations. This results in the following two equations. Already we've reduced our system of equations to five equations with five unknowns. Since IS only appears in one equation and is not related to any other quantities, we'll ignore it for now. We can then use substitution to reduce our system of equations. We can substitute the equation for I1 into the relationship below and substitute the equation for I3 into the other equation here, resulting in two equations with two unknowns. We can then combine like terms. distributing the 11 ohms and combining the 11 ohms I2 and the 5 ohms I2 results in this equation. If we combine the 12 ohms I3 and the 8 ohms I3 in the second equation, we get this. We can then divide through the bottom equation by 5 ohms. Moving 4I3 to the other side, we have solved for I2. We can then substitute this into the equation above, resulting in the equation with a single unknown, I3. Performing the multiplication, we have 15 volts minus 64 ohms I3 minus 11 ohms I3. Combining the I3 terms, we have 15 volts minus 75 ohms times I3. Solving for I3 gives us I3 equals 1/5 of an amp, which from our previous equations is also equal to I4. Remembering that I2 is equal to 4 times I3 gives us that I2 is 4/5 of an amp. Remembering that I1 is equal to I2 plus I3 gives us I1 is 5/5 of an amp, which also is equal to Is. We can then substitute these known values into our Ohm's law equations to solve for the four voltages. To make this a little more practical, let's first convert the fractions to decimals. It is then just a matter of multiplication to solve for the four voltages. So the value for all our currents and voltages are summarized here. The values drawn back into the schematic would look like this. Hopefully at this point, we could recognize at least two things. First, using Ohm's law, KCL and KVL, we can solve any circuit that contains sources and resistors. Second, that even for a relatively simple circuit, this is a fairly long and tedious process. The first realization gives us the confidence that we can solve any resistive circuit. The second realization probably makes us hope that there is a more efficient way to do this. Thankfully, there are many other ways. By applying these three laws to several different situations, we'll begin to notice patterns, and from those patterns, we can develop some more efficient ways of solving circuits. In the next couple of videos, we'll define series and parallel connections, and from there, see if we can notice anything about those arrangements that can make the process of solving a circuit less painful. That's all for today. Until next time, go out and make it a great one.